Blog Talk Radio.
N5D Radio, the next dimension in radio, where we bring you the hottest, in-depth, spiritual, metaphysical, esoteric conversations and news with your hosts, Greg Prescott and Kendra Gilbert. Get ready for spirit, body, and mind to expand in 3, 2, 1.
Greetings, everyone, and welcome to Quantum Healing with Candace. I am your host, Candace Craw Goldman, and today is September 25th, 2015, and this is episode number 2. This program was created to assist humans in this rapidly changing world, and its foundation is based upon the late, great Dolores Cannon's work and humanity's new understanding and acceptance of the quantum world and the role that consciousness plays in shaping both our individual and collective realities. I'm a full-time practitioner of Dolores' method and have had the honor and privilege of working with and alongside of her for several years before her death last October 2014. I'd like to start out by thanking N5D for its support of quantum healing and Dolores Cannon and all of those who continue her work and discoveries in healing. If you love stories of healing and health, consciousness, or if you are a fan of Dolores Cannon and her convoluted universe stories, you're going to love this show. Tonight, I'm going to welcome a very special friend and guest, Mary Truitt. And this evening, Mary and I are going to first briefly talk about QHHT, which is quantum healing hypnosis, what it is and what it is not. And then we're going to discuss this amazing healing and adventures of Mary's recent client, Miguel. So what I'd like to do now is welcome Mary Truitt to the show. Hi, Mary. Mary is a level 3 QHHT practitioner, and she received a BA from Sarah Lawrence College and an MFA from Columbia University, and she taught literature and creative writing at George Washington University for many years before moving to Annapolis and opening her hypnosis and healing practice. And in addition, she's published many short stories and essays, won multiple awards and nominations for her writing. She studied a wide range of esoteric literature and is particularly drawn to the dream work. The same problem. So I'm going to ask, I know that Michelle is in the chat room. Okay, can you hear me, Michelle? Can you hear me? Oh, dear. Okay. I am not muted. I am online. No. Okay, so Michelle, I don't know, did you hear that what I said about Art Bell? that quite a few technical issues. I guess it. So we're just going to have to deal with it, and I'm thankful to all of you out there who have the patience while we figure this out. And I'm looking for my friend Mary. Let's see. Mary, are you there?
Yes, I was cut out for a while, but now I'm back, I think. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you, Mary. It is truly Mercury in retrograde. This has been a crazy month of energy, and we have proved it in a stunning form the first few minutes of this show.
There you go. Well, hopefully we've paid our debt. We've paid our karmic debt there. Now everything will be fine.
Oh, I say that it will. It absolutely will. So
First of all,
let me once again, in case you didn't hear me before, I would like to welcome you so very much to this, our very second show of Quantum Healing with Candace. Are you still there?
I'm still here, absolutely.
Oh,
you're
excellent.
Welcoming me. I thought you were welcoming everybody else.
I am.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, thank you. I'm so glad to be here.
I just wasn't sure if you heard me before. And yes, let's welcome everyone who is joining us this evening and having the patience for us to actually get started while we're doing these hiccups here at first. And so today's show is going to be very, very interesting. First, you and I will talk just a little bit about QHHT. And we're going to do that because not everyone knows what QHHT is. And after we talk a little bit about what that is, we're going to invite your client, Miguel, to the show to talk about a very special session that he had. So why don't we start with, let's define, for those out there in the audience who really don't know Dolores Cannon and QHHT or quantum healing hypnosis, let's define that for everyone. Would you like to take that one? How would you tell somebody who didn't know what QHHT was, what it was?
Well, I guess, you know, the thing that I would say is that QHHT is an amazing way to explore what makes us tick, you know, whether we're exploring the realm of our imagination or the realm of what people call reality. You know, through hypnosis, people's resistance to knowing themselves as multidimensional really does lower, and people are able to experience what I would like to think of as sort of their multidimensionality in a very creative and healthy way. And so what happens is, you know, I mean, I'm not going to go through the whole history of how Dolores discovered this, but through hypnosis,
sure,
people explore past, present, parallel, and future lives, quote unquote, and experience incredible levels of healing and understanding of themselves in every way, spiritually, physically, and mentally.
Yes, it's absolutely true. It's the exploration of consciousness with the idea that consciousness is king, really, and that it can accomplish so many things, and sometimes in a stunningly fast and very direct way, and sometimes in a more slow and subtle way. So it is all things. What I loved about Dolores' work was it embraced it all. There are many other regressionists out there, people who use hypnosis to explore consciousness and past lives or portions of consciousness out there. I'm thinking of some very well-known other, mostly men, to tell you the truth, who explored slices of consciousness or parts of past lives. You know, there's the wonderful Brian Weiss who explored past
mm-hmm.
lives. And then there's the amazing Michael Newton who did his exploration exploring that space between lives between lives. And
yep.
then there's Barbara Lamb who did regressions to find out how people interacted with extraterrestrials. And you know what Dolores Cannon did? Dolores Cannon did it all.
Yep.
She just did it all, and it didn't matter. She had this, you know, amazing way of looking at it and seeing the big picture, and is really quite brilliant in her method. And happily, she took the last part of her life and traveled the world and taught her method to many people around the entire planet. Her method of healing and balance and knowledge, exploration, you know, learning. And that work is carrying on. And that's what you and I are doing right now.
Mm-hmm. Yes. And I would even add to that, the thing that to me is so amazing about Dolores is that if you begin at the beginning of her work, she is such a wonderful student of all of this. And, you know, she began as a complete novice, you know, just starting her hypnosis sessions for quitting smoking and losing weight and so forth and so on. And by the end, she was exploring what people would consider really, probably at that point, even she said she would have considered it crazy stuff, you know, off-planet lives and inner-Earth lives and all sorts of things. And so if one reads her books from beginning to end, you travel the arc of her learning with her, and her learning curve is the same as ours. You know, how can we even believe that this is happening? Because she couldn't believe it. And I love one of her quotes, which was, every time she says, well, I guess you've taught me everything you need to teach me now, they say, oh, no, we've just begun. Just a crack in the door. So it continues to expand, and she led the way, a real trailblazer of this work.
She really was a real trailblazer. And she used to say in classes that they spoon-fed her. And I kind of liked that. And I think it's how we all come to this. We get a crack in our psyche. We get a crack in the matrix, as Michelle might say. Something breaks down in front of us, and then we start asking questions, and then things come tumbling down. And with QHHT, that's the way it worked. And Dolores worked almost 50 years exploring consciousness in this way. And she started out with past lives, and then, like Mary said, just built upon that and slowly built upon that until we are where we are today. And I would say, I mean, it's just right at a year since Dolores left physical plane. And I would say that we have even made new discoveries even since Dolores has passed. Wouldn't you say that's true, Mary?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. It's growing. It's never stops growing and expanding.
It really is. You know, I had a client just today, and I'll throw this right out because I thought it was so amazing. One of the reasons I love this work so much is I learn something absolutely every day. And today's client actually was talking about her contract about coming to the planet to become human, and her SC, which is what we call the subconscious or the superconscious, or the soul's consciousness. We like to shorten that to the term SC because, as Dolores said, they don't care what you call it as long as you talk to it. But the great power that has the answers was telling my client just today, just a few hours ago in session, that she had a contract for her human life here and that her conscious mind was kind of breaking the contract, trying to take control of the contract. And her SC, her soul self, was saying, there's a life extension clause in her contract. Have you ever heard of that?
No, I haven't heard of that. No.
A life extension clause. She was concerned about her health. And the client, the SC of this client said, she has a life extension clause that can go into effect if she follows her life path as dictated and planned out by her soul.
Interesting.
Meaning she can live a much longer, much healthier, much fuller life if she tames the kind of ego, analytic, conscious mind that is trying to control all of the details in her life. If she can kind of put that portion of her being over into the passenger seat rather than the driver's seat, she can have a longer life, and the extension of her lifespan will be enacted as far as her soul contract goes. I thought
that's
that was
wonderful.
Stunning.
Yeah, and especially because probably through the session today, she has that choice of whether she wants to extend it or not.
I see. And so we're still saying we're having problems with echoes. I'm going to turn something off, and you tell me if you can still hear me. I'm going to count to 10, so you tell me if you can hear
me. You know what,
Candace?
This
is kind of crazy. Yes.
I think we're okay now. My friend who told me that they were having echoes say that they're okay now. So I think I think we might be all right.
All right. I'm trying to understand if there's – okay. I just got a message, too. There's no echo problems. Well, thank you. Thank you, everybody. Trying to figure out this system. It's brand new to me. I appreciate your patience. It looks like we may have the echoes under control. Again, Mercury in retrograde. So,
yeah, good.
So that's QHHT, so many things. So in QHHT, in quantum healing hypnosis, in the exploration that Dolores Cannon had mapped out for us in consciousness, we accept clients to be Indiana Jones in their own minds. They come for a variety of reasons. Many come for health concerns. Some come for relationship issues. Others to learn what their life path is. But in the construction of a QHHT session, we first have some sort of exploration. Now, that used to always be past lives. But it's no longer that. It's these other things that can possibly come forth, like Mary described. And after we have that exploration, we then talk to that larger portion of the client, the SC, the bigger part, the soul self, the higher self. And that is the part that helps us with healing and answers questions. So that's the basic construction and the basic framework of QHHT. And now that we've sort of defined that, I'd really like to know, Mary, about this fabulous session that you have with this client of yours named Miguel, who we hope to talk to here a little later on in the show. Would you tell us about his session?
Sure. His session was interesting because it had a lot of the elements that we find in clients who are seeking QHHT. So he called me and said, I need a session instantly. I have this imperative. Mm-hmm. I've discovered Dolores' work, and I must have a session as soon as possible. And he lived 5 hours away. I said, there are lots of practitioners up there. I'm very busy in the next couple of weeks. And he said, no, I need to come see you. There was another practitioner he had thought about going to, but they were also very busy. And, I just felt intuitively, this guy just sounds really like he needs some help. And I switched some things around so that he could come in. And, he felt very, very blocked, he said. He said that he had many insights and sort of intuitive flashes. And in fact, he'd even had a music teacher who had called him into his office years ago, who didn't even know him, who sort of made a prophecy about him and said, your sound is your sword. You need to fight your battles with sound now. He's a very talented musician and songwriter. And, he'd had all of these things, and yet he could never act on any of his things. He's very, very stuck. And so his purpose for wanting to come to the session was to unstick himself and to be able to move forward into some direction that was healthy for him and also that served the higher purpose he felt he had. And he is a nurse, and so he works in the healing arts. So he has these kind of two lines of his life. One is being a musician, and the other is being a nurse and helping people that way. But as he said, he's an overthinker and trapped in this kind of, which direction does my life go in next? And part of that also is that he'd broken his ankle a few months before, very, very bad break, and he'd been really, I think, almost on bed rest. His ankle had been in some kind of cast for 10 weeks, he had very serious scoliosis, which is a curvature of the spine that he'd been born with. And so his legs mm-hmm. and hips were out of alignment. He had a terrible heart problem where as soon as he began to exercise, his heart would begin beating out of control very fast. He had problems with his ears, with not being able to hear well, not being able to see well, astigmatism. He just had many, many physical issues. And so he came in for a session, and I think, you know, we hit on a lot of things. He had a parallel life, which had to do with the shift of the planet, which a lot of people, I think, probably know about if they're listening to this show.
Right.
And what we saw was a similar theme in all of the lifetimes he was shown. So, I mean, I can talk a little bit about that if you like, or we can
sure.
wait for him. So do you want me to actually go into what the lifetimes were?
Sure, yeah.
Okay. So, you know, we had our interview, which lasted, I think, about probably 2 or 2.5 hours. That's something we do as QHHT practitioners. We have a very long mm-hmm. interview with the client. And, you know, we just unpack their experience, you know, mind, body, heart, spiritual, sort of spiritual needs, really give them a safe space to talk about their lives. And that creates an atmosphere in which the client can really it feels comfortable, I think, hopefully, becoming mm-hmm. hypnotized and relaxing to the point where they can experience this wonderful work. So we had our interview, and then we went through the induction. And his first life, he found himself on a gray planet with lots of rocks and craters. And he saw himself, I asked him to see himself visually, what is your body, what kind of, you know, person are you? And he saw mm-hmm. a white suit with a gold kind of jacket, kind of armored, wearing a helmet. And as he stood there, he looked around and he was surrounded by a group of what we call grays, the small gray mm-hmm. Off-planet friends. Sometimes friends, and there was one person standing next to him, a gray standing next to him, who's clearly in charge, who was waiting for instructions. So often we find ourselves as practitioners, we don't start at once upon a time. You know, we don't start with a person being a baby and growing up. You know, we often find ourselves, in literature it's called in media reis, which means in the middle of things. So you're all of a sudden, you know, either in the middle of a battle where someone's being, you know, stabbed to death, or you're in the middle of something. So this moment of decision, very important moment of decision, he's looking around at these grays, he's on this planet, on this place, which I assumed was the moon just because of the craters and the gray, and this gray is awaiting instructions, and the gray wanted to know what to do next. So I asked him, of course, what the decision was, and it turned out that his job, he was what's called a Nordic. He's very tall and thin with blonde hair and blue eyes. He says that he was from the planet Sirius, and that his job was to influence the Earth, influence people who were struggling with moving into the right direction in terms of turning towards the light. There was a lot of influence coming from, I guess I would call them entities who wish the Earth ill, and that his job was to direct and help people turn towards the light. And mm-hmm. it wasn't working as effectively as he wanted to, and so he essentially gave this gray instructions to go down to the planet and collect entities that were not wishing the Earth well, and he collected them into a glass container, a kind of an invisible container, into what he called one of the hollow places of the moon. He said there are many hollow places within the moon where different off-planet people go, and he contained them, and he described the three races that they were containing there. I don't know if you want me to go into that.
Well, sure, why not? I mean, whatever is fascinating and interesting to you, Mary, I'm sure is going to be fascinating and interesting to our audience.
Of course, the whole thing's fascinating to me. I was like, well, who's in this container that you're going to do something with? So He said that there were three types of entities. The first type of entity was gray, and they had scales. They were apparently pretty horrible and scary looking. Two arms, mm-hmm. you know, two legs, two feet, just looked mm-hmm. like, I guess, gray, horrible people. And the second kind of entity was red, and they had mm-hmm. fishbowl-shaped heads and very sharp features, sharp teeth, sharp ears, sharp yellow eyes, sharp fingers. And the third type was blue, and they looked very much like the reds, but they were they lived underwater. The reds are surface dwellers, and the blues live in the water, and they're shorter and sturdier. And these three groups were living, intermingling with humans on the planet.
Wow!
And of course, I asked, well, do we see them walking down the street? Like, who are they? You know, what's going on? And he said that human beings are programmed not to see them, that is easier than their having to cloak themselves.
Huh. Wow. That's really interesting. Wow.
Yeah.
So,
And they control a lot of, they feed on fear, and that they control media images and feed on fear. And, you know, I said, what are you going to do with these guys? You know, you're going to keep them on the moon. What are you doing with them? And he said, we send them in a container to the eye of Saturn, where we send them into the vortex, and they're absorbed forever. They can never come back out again. And that's what his job was to do.
Mary, did Miguel talk about, did he describe how big this container was? I mean, was this some sort of huge thing or some sort of, you know, box you could carry under your arm or what?
You know, I did not ask that question. I mean, you can imagine how many questions there are to ask. The first question I asked was, well, if these guys are walking around on the planet, how do we protect ourselves from them?
All right.
And mm-hmm. what he said was, love. He said, think thoughts of love.
Yeah.
Don't buy into fear. Live in a vibration of love, and they have no use for you.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Interesting. Yeah, and they don't become part of your reality, which then again is right back to Dolores Cannon and some of the things that she always taught us. So, so he had this one life of this Nordic commander on the moon, and then what was his next life?
Well, let me just say one thing about this life, which is, you know, so
sure.
some people might say, how can he have that life? It's happening right now, because he said this was happening at the same time as this life he's in now. So this is what mm-hmm. we would call in QHHT, of course, a parallel life, which means, you know, because we believe time doesn't exist, that there are parts of us in many different dimensions and many different lifetimes at once. So I just wanted to make that point. I asked him to go to the next important day, another important day in his life, which is the way we kind of move around in QHHT, of course. And he leapfrogged, mm-hmm. which is a term that Dolores invented, which means that you simply go to another lifetime. You simply go to a completely different lifetime. And that was what he did. And he was on a horse in the middle of an open prairie, riding along, and he was a soldier wearing battle gear. And he thought he was a samurai, but it turned out later that he was Indian. And he was a very brave soldier in charge of a whole army. And he said, I am working as part of a caravan of fear, and we need to fight the West. The West is encroaching on our life, and I need to take an army and go fight a great battle.
Could you ascertain the time frame of this at all?
Yes.
Even vaguely?
He said, we're fighting Romans.
Uh-huh.
And so I know a little bit about that time period, and, you know, there were many, many skirmishes and wars fought during that time between the Romans, the Greeks, the Indians, the Persians, everybody was fighting. But he did ultimately, I said, is there a god you worship? And he said, my god is blue. And that was when I realized it was Krishna. So he was traveling to the West to fight the Roman army. And that was actually very interesting because we took him to the actual night of the before the battle, the great battle that he was going to fight in. And he said that he had this foreknowledge that he was going to die the next day. He knew that the battle, that they would lose the battle. And so I said, well, what did you do with your evening? If you knew you were going to die the next day, how did you spend your evening? And it was wonderful. He said, I enjoyed the evening. He said he walked around.
What a brilliant question. What a brilliant question, Mary. Way to go. Yeah, what do you do? It's your last
evening. What do you
do? Yeah. It's like a Facebook quiz thing, but it's actually real, you know.
What do you do? Yeah, and he said he walked around the camp and talked to the men. They told stories. They sat around the fire. And there was this is the kind of detail that makes, for me, QHHT so interesting, which is that he said that he took a couple of men aside, and he did not tell them, we're not going to make it tomorrow. What he did was he said, I need you to take some messages back to home, and I need you to give them, he sort of trumped up, I have the feeling, some messages, and it was because he wanted them to be the leaders of the next battle that needed to be fought. He wanted to save their lives, and so he picked the men whose lives he wanted to save and sent them home that night as messengers.
What a marvelous detail.
Mm-hmm.
Beautiful.
It's just so, for me, so poignant. And so the next day, you know, he went into battle, and he took an arrow in his neck and fell off his horse. And he had a beautiful sword. I loved his description of his sword. It was short and curved and had a ruby at the hilt. And he said, my sword is my friend. And, you know, it made me, of course, think of what he had told me earlier about the prophecy where the professor from his music school had said to him, sound is your sword.
Mm-hmm.
So it sort of harked back to that, you know.
Sure.
In this lifetime, sound is your sword. In those days, you had that sword. But anyway, so he fell off his horse, and then the Roman, who was masked, came over to him and took his sword and cut him from his neck down to his groin, just a straight cut. So, of course, he died on the battlefield. And, you know, but he said, I didn't mind dying. I was fighting a good cause. And, you know, he didn't mind dying. And because we see these as an observer, when we know someone's going to be possibly suffering some physical discomfort, we, you know, say to them, you'll see this as an observer. And so,
mm-hmm.
so they don't feel pain. So that's very important. That's what happened to him in that lifetime.
And that wasn't it, right? I mean, there was another lifetime after that.
No. No, there was, well, also there was, we went to, you know, the life between lives at that point. He lifted up out of his body, went towards the light, and as he went into the light, three figures appeared in the distance. And I asked the three figures to come forward, and the first figure was a man with a short gray beard and brown hair. And I asked him to identify himself, and he was called the Divinator. And the Divinator is the man who basically knows your lives and knows where you need to go next. And the Divinator was very eager for him to immediately go into another life because he is a very important, you know, you can see already a pattern, of course, between these two lives.
Right.
And so he wanted him to instantly go back into another life. The next person was a young woman who Miguel recognized as kind of a woman that he loves in this lifetime. And I said, why is she there? And he said, to remind me why I fight, which I thought was beautiful. And the third figure was a young boy. And at first, he would not identify himself. And after a little bit of pushing and prodding, the boy said, "I'm your future son. You haven't had me yet." And, you know, these three figures were really pretty wonderful as greeters in death. You know, your future son greets you in a past life. Sort of, you know, so many
about,
dimensions.
Talk about pretzel bending. This really pretzel bends your mind, like Dolores used to say. You have to really be open to the fluidity of consciousness and time.
Yep, absolutely. And, you know, I said, "Would you like to embrace this son of yours?" And he said, "It's not the time yet. That's not the right thing." So I thought of another question. I said, "Do you want to ask him a question? Is there anything he wants to tell you? Is there anything he wants to tell you?" And this was my favorite part of the session, I think. The boy said to him, "Find my mother." Which I thought was just wonderful.
Oh, isn't that interesting? Oh, I can't wait to ask Miguel about that one.
Yeah, find my mother. So
I wonder what happened after that. Oh, interesting.
Yeah.
And so then what happened?
So then I said, "Hey, let's go to a temple of healing," because I just felt that he needed some healing at that point. He'd had the arrow in the neck. And, you know, Miguel himself, of course, needed healing. And as a practitioner, I'm always trying to find, you know, a little handhold somewhere. I always think of it as like the people who climb those sheer rocks, who take a finger and poke it in a little tiny hole and pull their entire body up a sheer rock, you know. I just try to find little places that I can squeeze in the healing, because to me, that's really the most important part. The stories are wonderful, but the healing is what the client really comes for. So I said, "Let's go to a healing temple. Let the three of them take you somewhere." So they took him to a beautiful healing temple, which was made entirely of blue crystal. He said he thought it might be topaz. And they levitated him there, and he found himself in this cave with just levitating in the middle of the cave. He wasn't even on the ground or anything, just floating there in space. And three more figures came forward. And the first figure was a female, and she had dark skin. He said purplish in color. And he said her name was Shiera. I don't really know how to spell it, but her name was Shiera. She wore a white gown, and she had gold all around her heart chakra, just gold right around there. And the second figure was very much like the first one, but she was just watching. She was not there to do any work. She was just there to watch. And she had a yellow stone on her heart, which he observed. The third figure was a male with black skin wearing a headdress with stripes on it, like a pharaoh might wear, and a gown of some kind. And he had the ears of a cat.
Of course he did.
Yeah. So, you know, I am familiar with Bast, who is usually considered a female Egyptian goddess who's a cat.
Mm-hmm.
But I had not really known about a male figure who was a cat. And the three of them just began to do all kinds of healing on him. You know, they worked through his chakras. They worked on his scoliosis. They gave him a reason for why he'd broken his ankle. They said his life was going too quickly, and that he needed to protect his heart, and he needed something to sort of slow him down.
Mary, may I ask, was it his right ankle or his left ankle? And did that matter in this situation?
You know, let's ask Miguel, because, you know, I think it might have been his right ankle. And you can clarify why that's important if you like. Listeners
well,
might
we'll
not
definitely,
know.
Yeah, we'll definitely ask him. One of the reasons I ask is because, and it's not often the case, but, I mean, it's not always, excuse me, is what I meant to say. You can't always say this, but what we do is we tend to look at the sides of the body as sometimes clues about when the problem, the root cause of the problem originated. So in general, the right side of the body indicates current problems or issues. And in general, the left side of the body can indicate past issues that are affecting the current life. And those are just generalities, but they're helpful when you're trying to ascertain what's going on. So I always ask these kinds of things. My lady today had every one of her issues on her left side, including, you know, her left eye, the left part of her heart. And she had a big old birthmark on her left flank, too, that she didn't even tell me about. Of course, it was all over. It was suddenly everything made sense. But why don't you tell us just a little bit about what happened during then the SC portion and as he woke up, and then we'll have Miguel on and sort of get his take on everything and his viewpoint about the session and what happened. So how did this wrap up? What was it like when it finished? And
Sure. Well, he had a lot of healing. There was a lot of healing that went on. It was very specific things that were done. And a lot of advice from the healers themselves. They would sort of put thoughts into his head. When we got to the SC, the SC was so full of wisdom and, you know, gave us a few sentences that were just so beautiful that, you know, I find myself thinking about them over and over again. The SC said things like, you know, don't seek out of need. You know, he was asking about would he be able to be with this woman that he loves, and it said, don't seek out of need. My favorite thing, maybe, I don't know, there were so many wonderful things the SC said, but one thing the SC said was, in terms of the shift, I asked about the shift that's going on now on the planet, and the SC said, people need to stop observing the prison being built around them and start removing the bricks. Which I loved.
Yeah, beautiful.
Yeah, and then, you know, Miguel had been feeling, you know, it was funny because in the lifetimes that we saw, and there was one more that the divinator showed him, which if people are interested in, I'll have it in my blog. He was a little bit feeling like, hey, I'm a nurse now. I'm not a, you know, great warrior on the prairie. I'm not like a commander of, you know, people up on the moon. I'm a nurse. And the subconscious said, which I thought was so beautiful, helping one is as important as helping thousands.
Yeah, that's really true. And we know that from even, you know, David R. Hawkins and some of those ideas and thinking about raising the consciousness of just a few people affects thousands and thousands around you, even sometimes when you don't realize it, you make quite a bit of a difference in life and world.
Amazing session. I loved that, yeah. And of course, you know, there's so much more. You know, there's so much detail in these sessions, and it's hard to every session is practically a book. So it's hard to convey. Yeah, it's amazing.
You know, Mary and I were talking before the program about these sessions, and you have a session like Miguel's, which is so rich and so deep and so beautifully filled with all of these details. I mean, what stones were where and the colors and who says what. And I don't, you know, the divinator, have you ever even run across that character before?
No,
I don't think I have.
I've run across people like that who plan lives. They've been called something else, the planner or the, you know, but not the divinator.
Sure. Beautiful. And there's so much information that you a human brain can't even, you cannot keep it in your head. You just can't. You know, we're not built like that.
No.
Except for there was one person who could do that, and that was Dolores Cannon.
Never forgot anything. Yeah.
Dolores Cannon was like, I don't know, she was like some sort of amazing computer program or Rolodex. She had it all right there, all the way to the end. She could tell you. I even once, I even once heard her say, when somebody asked about a certain prophecy in Nostradamus books, and I heard her like call across the room and say something along the lines of, well, that's on, you know, that's in volume 2 on page 112.
Wow.
I mean, I swear to God, she said that. And I thought,
it's amazing.
This person's not built the same way that I am, because that's not me.
Yeah, just amazing. Just amazing.
Yeah. Well, let's go ahead and welcome Miguel to the program and get his take and his perceptions of everything that you've said and what this was all like for him. And I'm going to unmute Miguel's mic right now. And Miguel, can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
Hi, Miguel.
Hi, Miguel.
Welcome.
Hi, Mary. Hi, Candace.
Thank you so much for joining us this evening. And really, thank you, Miguel, from the bottom of my heart, because I've been doing this work for a very long time. And clients like you, even the ones who have amazing, very positive, miraculous stories to share, rarely come forward and share them publicly for any number of reasons, and I'm learning more and more of those reasons as I practice, and they're all valid. But to have somebody actually come forth and talk to the people who are listening to this program this evening, and the archived version in the future, Miguel, you truly are helping other human beings in a different capacity, even than being a nurse, which is this wonderful practitioner, this wonderful job to have, you know, anyway, that helps people. But coming on air and talking about this session is going to help others, because sometimes I think people listen to these stories and they consider them fantastic and unbelievable and maybe exaggeration. And we get to hear your perspective on everything that Mary said, and we get to hear you talk about what this was like for you. So welcome, and thank you again. And tell us about how this all happened for you. How did you discover Dolores, and how did you find Mary? And what's the beginning of the story for you?
Well, I've known about quantum hypnosis for a while now, maybe about 2 years. I know about Dolores Cannon. I'm a fan of George Norrie Overnight, so you know I've heard her before, and she was also supposed to be at a hypnosis conference I attended last fall, but she passed and wasn't able to attend. So I've heard of her and her sessions, but I haven't fully been to one yet. But this year, I just seemed like everything I wanted to do just ended up going the complete opposite way. So I said, you know what, something is up, and I need to call out the big guns right now. So I just started looking up for quantum hypnosis practitioner, and I found Mary. I was actually able to find Mary through just her site, because I had gone through a few people, but I just felt right when I found her. When I spoke to her, I felt comfortable, and also it was the right time, and she, you know, probably responded back to me just when, you know, I need to see her respond. So I just started seeing all those synchronicities and said, you know, probably this is the person I should see. So mm-hmm. I just gave her a call and went from there.
So what was the main reason you were seeking a session?
The main reason is because it just seemed like whatever I want to do in my life, it just complete opposite happened. You know, my ankle broke, like she said, it was the right ankle, and I was on bed rest. I was on bed rest for about 8 weeks, and I really couldn't move. The doctor told me, listen, he looked at me sternly and said, if you move more than 15 to half an hour a day, you know, we may have to do this again. You know, it was that bad, and I went from that to pretty much having to learn how to walk again, and just I felt like it was a lost year. Like, I had to start all over again from scratch with everything, and I figured if I want to really start over from scratch, why not start with some clearing and with some ideas of where I should go next, and so I don't end up in a So I end up in a better situation than in bed post-surgery again. So that's pretty much the biggest reason why I went to see Mary.
So, Miguel, had you had experience with hypnosis at all? Did you know what to expect, or what was your thinking going in?
Well, I know what to expect. I had hypnosis in college. A professor, he was a business professor, but he also was psychology. And he, you know, taught some of the students, because I went to a performance school, so some people have performance anxiety or whatever, so he helped some of the students with that, and also taught, his main thing was just teaching you how to hypnotize yourself, how to make, how to phrase the affirmations or what you're going to do. So I've had a couple sessions before. I've also had five-path, Cal Banyan type of session, but not a regression session. So the biggest thing I knew was to, you know, just relax and just let go and just let whatever is supposed to come, but I didn't know what to expect. Because I'm not sure if I believed in the whole past life thing. Well, then I didn't. That was a different story. But I just approached everything with an open mind and said, let's see what happens. Because Dolores and the thousands of people and who've gone through this, they can't be all crazy. So it was just pretty much going with an open mind and relax and let the professional, you know, do her work.
Mm-hmm. So what did your conscious mind think? Did your conscious mind go along for the ride? Was it paying attention? Were you having a little part of yourself that was analyzing what was going on, or what?
Yeah, I think there was a point where my conscious mind came back up a little bit, and Mary kind of smacked it down, maybe about an hour and a half.
That
in.
Down. That was right before. That was right before we went to this. We started to go into the subconscious, and you know, Miguel started using his mind. He's like, "Well, my amygdala did this, and my medulla did that," and I was like, "Yeah, this is not working." You know, you go. I sent him back to the blue cave and said, "You just go rest over there while I talk to your subconscious," and that worked very quickly and well. Yeah.
Yeah, because I have a tendency to, I think at times, just overthink, overanalyze, and, you know, the critical mind is still always there instead of more the subconscious, more observing. So I think a lot in the beginning I started saying to myself, what in God's name are you saying? You know, do you believe this stuff? And then I said, another part was like, be quiet, just sit back and relax and just really just kind of say, what happens is more sort of like a fleeting little thought or like a fleeting glimpse of something. You kind of have to just kind of catch on to it and just trust and talk and see where it goes from there. And I think that's more the letting go aspect of quantum hypnosis, that it's not going, for me anyway, it wasn't like a vivid movie screen like you're in a movie theater and you're seeing something. It's sort of like a, it's like seeing an image through fog or smoke, and then the more you kind of focus on it and let it go and trust, the more it comes through, and then you go from there. But you definitely have to let that critical mind go of trying to figure out what's happening as you're talking.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You had some remarkable detail, though. I mean, Mary was able to speak about incredible details about colors and shapes and costumes and all kinds of things. It was really quite amazing. May I ask, Miguel, are you a daydreamer? Do you remember your dreams? Did any of these scenes or images surprise you?
They all surprised me. I daydream a lot in the sense of I try to kind of think about what I'm going to do, or I drift off a lot, but sometimes I remember my dreams if they're very, very profound. And, you know, I write them down, and what usually happens is, you know, I review the book like every year, 18 months, and I look back and I realize that, you know, the dream or the event that I had in the dream did come true. So I do have a lot of prophetic dreams, if you want to say that, but it's a family thing. It happens to my mother. My grandmother had it, a couple of her sisters, so I think it's something that just runs down the line of our family, but nothing that I spoke about in the session was anything close to anything I've ever dreamed of. It was all very much brand new to me.
Mm. You know, Miguel, I'd love to hear from you. I know people probably want to hear about your physical healings, and I'd like to hear about both your physical healings and also just what your feeling is about your biggest takeaway from the session. You know, more than the body, you know, more than your sort of what you're doing with your life now, but just sort of spiritually what your big takeaway was. So maybe you could just speak about those things. I think of heart, mind, and spirit. If you could just talk a little bit about what the takeaway was for you.
Okay, well, first the physical healing, I guess, is something, you know, someone like me needs, you know, the constant criticizer looking for something to happen in this five-sense reality. And I was pretty much limping when I went in to see you. And when I left, the pain decreased by at least, you know, 50%. On the way home, the first time I stopped for gas, I was not limping anymore. And by the time I got home 2 hours later, total 5 hour, like all the pain was gone. And
Wow. The
pain I had before, because the ligaments weren't healing properly and a few of the things I have to go through. So the pain was actually increasing after the surgery instead of going down. And once I left the session, it had all gone away. And it's pretty much been like that since. I'm able to go to the office and do physical therapy and really push it hard and not have an issue with pain or limping when before I was physically, you know, leaning over and I say almost dragging my leg in. So that was, you know, a big change for me to show me that, hey, you know, this stuff really works. And you know, the heart-mind thing, I think for me the biggest thing is the trust, you know, and the faith thing, which has always been, you know, my problem is in the sense, or my challenge, let's say, and I want to see something right here, right now, instead of realizing that just because it's not here right now, it doesn't mean it hasn't happened yet. And sometimes you have to have faith and believe and act and work, you know, towards, you know, what you want, and it'll come eventually. It's that doubt that a lot of people have, and I think it's maybe it's an American thing that's been put in our brain since school, that conditioning thing of if you can't see it, touch it, feel it right now, it doesn't exist. And that includes anything you want, including, you know, a partner, love, whatever it is. Like, if you can't touch it right now, it's not really here. And I think the session proves something else.
It's interesting because I loved the first email I got from Miguel after the session was, I can't believe it, but my ankle is better. And then he said, no, I can't say I can't believe it because then I can't believe it. And then that was the thinking that, you know, got me to this place. So,
yes.
You know, immediately, Miguel, you realized you had to change your thinking, which was, go ahead.
Well, yeah, that's the can't believe thing. I want to, you know, the listeners know that what happened was when the situation I was living in, I was so great and things were going so well, I kept saying to myself, I can't believe it. You know, this is too real. This can't be happening. This is unbelievable. Because the person I was with, the young lady we spoke about earlier, I saw her in a dream before I met her. And then what happened was about a week in after meeting her, I had like deja vu in the kitchen sitting there staring at her on the couch and said, wait a second, I've been here before. This has all happened before. And that's when I realized she was the person that I had a dream about maybe 2 or 3 months earlier. So for like the next 2 days, I just kept saying to myself, this can't be real. This can't be happening. This can't be happening. I can't believe it. And then I just immediately broke my ankle, and the entire situation is pretty much was snatched right from me. And that's why I'm careful about saying I can't believe now, because I kind of brought that into being.
That's interesting. Yeah. What about... Can you tell us a little bit about some of the other parts of your body? So the ankle is feeling better. What about your heart, your ears, your eyes, your anything else? Any other changes you've seen?
Well, the ears, they within that week, once I listened to the program again and I also started, you know, acting more in the guidance I had, my ears started clearing up. a little bit. I remember I told you the biggest thing was, you know, listening. I don't listen, and then I block that energy, and that's part of the ear.
Right. But, the healers told him that the reason he had such a problem hearing and had buildup in his ears was because he wasn't listening to guidance.
And I think the heart was, for me, was a profound one because I had taken a stress test, not a medical one, but at a gym where you get on a treadmill and they have the heart monitor on and everything like that. And within 1 minute, you know, my heart rate went from resting of, let's say, 70, 75 beats per minute. It shot straight up to 133, you know, and was going higher and higher. And I just barely started walking. And the tests had to be stopped. And it just seemed like for the next few months, anytime I did anything, my heart rate just went from, you know, basically doubled. You know, within the space of 30 seconds or a minute, I was getting palpitations. I really didn't know what was going on. I had like a heaviness in my chest, you know, like what some people say before. I'm correct, like they have a stroke, not a stroke, but more of a heart attack. They feel like there's a heaviness, like something sitting on their chest. You know, mm-hmm. So I was doing some more alternative medicine with that, but what happened was I took a stress test maybe 2-3 weeks ago at a doctor, you know, echocardiogram, and with a picture of my heart and everything, and I was on the treadmill, and if it wasn't for, you know, the weakness in my ankle, I would have been able to run. My heart was fine. It got up to 170, and the doctor just stopped the test and said that we don't have any issues here. I wouldn't have been able... Before, I could barely walk without my heart rate doubling. Now, I was almost running, and I felt fine.
Wow. That makes me so happy, Miguel.
Yeah.
It really does. You deserve to feel that way. That's wonderful. That's just wonderful.
So that's a real, like, to me, that was, those two things are the biggest thing because I could feel the difference in my ankle, and, you know, I saw the difference in the stress test. I was expecting to get winded and not be able to continue. And they just kept increasing the speed, and my heart rate went up to my normal workout level, and there was no pain, no problem, no residual anything. I felt great. And that, you know, that wasn't happening, you know, just a couple months ago.
That's wonderful.
That's just amazing, Miguel. I'd like to ask, too, your drive home when you had already sort of thought about some of this, you know, that you'd created the other, that you created the other thing in your life where you know, you blocked what was coming for you. When you were saying this isn't happening, or when you felt that your ankle was feeling better, what was it like internally for you with your conscious mind? How were you talking to yourself about what was happening? Were you grateful? Were you questioning it? Are you questioning it now?
Well, my nature of the questioner. On the way home, I think the biggest thing I try to do is just to keep my mind clear and, you know, keep the radio off and just keep an open channel to sort of, you know, whatever thoughts or whatever energy was kind of flowing, just let it be. So that was the main thing I did. Of course, initially, I was like, well, I don't feel any different. Yes. And I was like, well, yes, my ankle feels better, but. And there was always that, yeah, but. And so the idea for me was just to not really think about it, not go over the session, but I know you just let the subconscious do its work and just process in that sense. And the first time it really hit me was when I got out at 11 o'clock at night, 11:30, going to the supermarket. And I didn't limp anymore, and there was no pain. And that's when I realized, okay, this stuff is real. It works. And off and on, I have the little doubt creeps in. But then I, you know, listen to the session, and I have to realize, hey, you took a stress test a couple weeks ago. You know, you passed. You know, you're feeling better every day. And the fact that this young lady called me after having spoke to her about 8 or 9 weeks after the session, and pretty much said, everything you said is right, you're right, you're right about everything. And it just seemed like so many things in my life were clicking and falling into place after the session. So in some senses, it's being grateful and looking at the good things that happened instead of doubting and saying, well, this didn't happen or, well, that didn't happen. So I think for me, it's just being grateful about all the changes and all the positive things that came out of the session.
That's wonderful. You know, Miguel, I don't know if you remember. Do you remember what the final advice the SC gave you was?
Well, one of the things I noticed that this was a
stop running from your fear. Yeah, but the very last, you know, Candace, I don't know if you do this, but at the end of all of my sessions, I say to the SC, do you have a final message for the client? Something that just kind of wraps up everything. And I have the quote right here in my notes. So, Miguel, this was what the SC said to you for your final piece of advice. The less you doubt, the more you'll know, and the more will come.
Wow. Yeah. Yeah.
So.
How wonderful.
It's a little bit of a snap, right? Oh.
Yeah.
There you go.
Yeah.
Just what you said.
Yeah. It makes absolute sense because, you know, so many times, and once again, it's a, I like to look at, I call it familial programming in the sense of, you know, certain things that the father and the mother does and the kid kind of inhabits. And, you know, my mother sort of does the same thing. Like, she'll have an intuition, not kind of follow it, then it'll pop up the next time. And, you know, that's a challenge for me, and I've been doing more of that. But it definitely, I realize that when you don't doubt or just let it go. And it's a technique I learned in improvising the piano. I couldn't improvise until a couple of years ago. And I found a teacher, and he just said, just play. He said, play anything. Stop thinking and stop criticizing. And the more I played and didn't worry about what was right or what was wrong, the more I noticed I was just watching my hands move. And over the weeks, it started getting better and better and more formed and started sounding good. And I wasn't thinking about anything. It's like something was playing through me.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that is what, you know, that message is. And I think that's what it can be for life when you hear athletes and musicians talk about being in that flow or that zone where they stop criticizing themselves. And I think, you know, a lot of people can do that, and I can do that more in my daily life. It's letting go and letting, you know, just flowing.
Mm-hmm. And do you think now as you move forward, are you feeling more compelled towards pursuing your music or your nursing or kind of both? What's your mindset at this point after the session?
You know, I'll definitely continue with some education nursing because I think that's definitely going to go somewhere. But, yes, I do feel, you know, more of an impetus to move forward musically, actually. A couple of days ago, I was in another state, and I was thinking, should I, you know, stay and work more, or do I need to work on music? And I was thinking yesterday, actually. Then I was listening to the session again, and I remember, you know, the little boy or the lady said, you know, you'll find her when you follow your path and you'll find this. And as I thought about that, I realized that, you know, why don't I, you know, get my music up on SoundCloud and these other outlets and all these other things that are going on. And it just clicked on me to do that, you know, during these couple of days. And that's part of my following the path, especially since I'm going to be on a radio show talking about following the path. And I realized that's what I need to be doing, so I'll be doing that over the next couple of days. So definitely more each week, things that I said in the session have, you know, pertinence into what's happening in my daily life, almost as if it was speaking about things that are going to happen in the future. So definitely I'll be continuing with nursing, and yes, I'm going to be, you know, working more on music. I already am right now.
That's wonderful. Yeah, let me know about your SoundCloud. I'd love to hear some music.
I'll send it to you.
That's great.
Miguel, I wonder if you might tell me, if you would, the nurse in you, the medical perspective of what you believe might have happened. I mean, you are somebody who sees things like x-rays and MRIs and tests, and you deal with that very materialistic scientific world.
Yes.
How do you match that with what happened in your world with healing?
Well, just to clarify a little bit, because I can't technically say, you know, I'm medical. It's two different kind of perspectives. There's nursing and then there's medical. And from my side, from what I know from seeing, you know, on a daily basis, just being a patient, there's a divide between the medical and the nursing. You know, the doctor comes in and they see a patient for a few minutes, but we see them for 8 hours or 12 hours. So there's really a big aspect of how the person feels and what they're thinking and what's going on in their life that really does affect how they feel or, you know, the medication or the food they're getting. So from my perspective with that, I think a lot of it has to do with energy healing. Just, you know, I pretty much focused on something I wanted and how I wanted to feel, and I worked with a practitioner, and I was able to create that in my body. I don't necessarily think the medical field is really ready for that as yet, you know, because a lot of times if the doctor doesn't believe in that, then sometimes it'll almost manifest in the patient. For instance, the cardiologist who was giving me the EKG, immediately I sat down and he's telling me what to expect and how the body breaks down at a certain age and why this doesn't work. And a lot of times patients will go along with it, but in my head I'm disagreeing with him completely, because your body doesn't have to fall apart at a certain point. You know, you don't have to need a medication. And he said, well, if it doesn't do well, you may need this medication, that medication, even before the test. And I think if it was another person's mind who wasn't really into hypnosis or alternative therapies, would have been really open or fearful. But in myself, I was saying, no, I'm not having any medication. I'm going to be fine. I'm going to be healthy. I'm going to be well. So to me, a lot of it has to do with the will. You see patients in a nursing home or hospital, and those who are more upbeat and those who are happier, a lot of times they tend to, you know, use less pain medication, or they have an easier time and an easier recovery than those who are, you know, don't get a lot of visitors, let's say, or family doesn't really show up. So I think your mental state has a lot to do with how your physical being comes out.
That's so interesting, Miguel, because, you know, I think I just heard the nurse in you talking.
Yeah.
And I think I heard kind of where, you know, this session especially can be so powerful for you in terms of the work you do. And, you know, it's funny because, you know, when I was younger, I had so many friends who went to go out and do Peace Corps or do, you know, all these great works. They had this calling to go help the universe get better and help the world and help thousands of refugees. And I have a very good friend in college with a beautiful heart, and she went and she worked in refugee camps in, I've forgotten which country it was in Africa, but really she just spent 8 years immersed in living in a tent and just helping child after child after child after child, you know, dying and drown, you know, just whatever, dying of thirst and starvation. And after about 8 years, she looked at the line of people at the tent and she thought, it's never going to end. And she moved to Italy. She married a count with lots of money, and she lived a beautiful, happy life, being very selfish. And, you know, she said, but what she did was every day she would help somebody. And I thought about that. I thought about her so much when in your session you said, you know, you help one, it's the same as helping thousands. Because we all know that we could line up at the local, you know, station where there are thousands of people in pain and help and help and help. But God, at a certain point, the beauty of just sitting with one person and looking into their eyes, looking into their soul and saying, I'm here with you. I'm helping you here right now. And that, the beauty of that is something that I feel as if you just spoke to us about, you know, letting somebody know that you're there with them and that they don't necessarily need to listen to the doom and gloom of the doctors, or, you know, they can ignore the fluorescent lights in the room or whatever. But that you can do that, Miguel, is an amazing thing.
Yeah, it definitely helps. After a while, and this one thing, you learn to trust your instincts in that job, because your instincts will allow you to leave on time at the end of the night. You know, there are times you feel like somebody is not doing well. One night I just, for some reason, I checked on this resident. You just kept feeling to check on them, and, you know, 4 o'clock in the morning, and, you know, her congestive heart failure, and she's having an episode. We have to send her out to the hospital. There's always that feeling that this person could die or this person is going out, and you kind of follow it, and you end up going down to a room to check on someone at a time. You shouldn't even be going down to that room, and there they are actually needing you. And that's where that whole thing about, you know, you help one, you help thousands, because, you know, everyone, you know, we're all connected in that sense.
Mm-hmm.
So
you're doing that thing again that we talked about during your session, Miguel, where you start switching to the second person, where you say, you notice this, you notice that,
uh-huh.
you think
that.
So, Miguel, remember what we talked about. When something turns really personal and important to you, this is when people switch to the you. And so if you could just say that entire thing over again using the word I instead, then that's where you align with your power and with the strength that you have to help people. Do you see what I'm saying?
Yes, I see you're trying to get me into my heart now. So
yeah, God, I'm so sorry.
It's okay.
I thought one session would do it. You might need another one. What are we going to do? When I feel the, you know, when I know that I need to go down there at 4 in the morning, when I get the feeling, you know, that is where you need to be, Miguel.
Yeah, I definitely see what you're saying.
You know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Isn't that interesting?
I don't know, Candace, if you noticed that in your practice, but I notice
did.
This all the time, that, you know, people will switch
did.
To the you. Oh,
yes.
You know how it is when you blank, blank. And the minute
mm-hmm.
I hear that, I'm like, no, no, no. Switch back to the I for me, please, because let's own this.
Mm-hmm.
No, you're definitely right. You're definitely right. I feel, just thinking about it, I feel a difference there. But I'm working on that.
Yeah. Now, there you go again. I'm working on it. How about I got this?
I got it.
Yeah, right.
I am that.
Yeah, that's me.
Right,
yeah.
Right. You know how this brings me to something that I try to say to almost all my clients while I'm in the session with them or before the session talking about this idea. You know, the Native Americans, when I read this, it was one of the biggest aha moments that I've ever had. And so when the Native Americans would do their rain dance, what they would do is they would set themselves up for ceremony, and they would, you know, make the circle, and they would take themselves to a sacred place, and they would dress up, and they would do all of that, and then they would sing, and they would dance, and they would have this communication with the Great Spirit. And we Westerners, at least I did anyway, would think, oh, that's a rain dance. They must be saying God or spirits or Mother Earth, please give us some rain. But that's not what they did at all. What they did was, in that dancing and in that singing and in that praising and in that communication and in that ritual, what they did was they said, thank you for the rain. I feel the rain on my body. I smell the rain in the air. They imagined that they created the idea of rain as real and as an emotional and as amazing that they could in their body. They tried with their imagination. They, you know, they endeavored to imagine raindrops coming down their body, et cetera, et cetera. So that's what a rain dance was, is they worked themselves into putting themselves into the now moment of rain, to bring the rain to them, rather than say, please give it to me. I need this. It needs to come later. I will have it. It was the now, you know, I have it, which kind of aligns with what you were saying, Mary.
Yeah, you know, it reminds me of Greg Braden's wonderful work where he says, I think he did a whole book on the nature of prayer and the different kinds of prayers there are. And there's, of course, the plea, which is, oh, God, help me kind of prayer. But,
mm-hmm.
of course, the most successful prayer is when you pray as if your prayer has already been answered. And so I think the, you know, the Indians who pray, whose prayer is actually the dance of feeling the rain, feeling the mud, feeling the, you know, that whole that whole thing of just knowing that it's already been taken care of. And so the showing the gratitude for that. And I think that's, mm-hmm. Miguel, what we're saying to you is, you know, own it. You've got it.
Yeah, I definitely agree. I've seen that aspect in many, you know, ancient writings. You see that, you know, I think it's in the Bible where it said to pray as if you already have it or received it. And Neville Goddard spoke about that. That's a big aspect in the sense of, I think that's where the knowing comes from, you know. I think I use the example of, you know, if I'm going to tie my shoes, I tie the shoe. I don't have to believe I can or think I will be able to, because that implies some sort of doubt. I don't have to make affirmation saying,
yeah,
I can't tie my shoes, I will be able to, because that implies that you can't in doubt. I just tie the shoe, and that's that knowing that we're talking about.
Right. And, mm-hmm. And it's hard to catch yourself because, of course, we say things like, wow, I can't believe this is happening, or I'm never going to understand that person. And, of course, the minute you say it, you never will understand that person, you know.
Right.
You have to watch the language and the power of the words. And I think as QHHT practitioners, we do understand the power of the words because Dolores's script will carry people to other dimensions. And, you know, the script isn't that long. It's just a couple of pages. And yet, mm-hmm. when people lie on the bed and they breathe quietly and hear these words, you travel to unbelievably interesting places. So words, you know, words really are so important. And I think we have to watch our language, you know.
We really do. You know, that whole thing that we were told as children, sticks and stones may break my bones, but words can never hurt me. That is just so wrong. I mean, it's so wrong, meaning, you know, if you allow them, and words have energy, and they absolutely can change things, and they can be very hurtful. And sometimes, you know, I don't know about you, Mary, but I deal with a lot of abuse people, a lot of abuse. And human beings can put up with sometimes physical abuse easier than they can put up with mental abuse or emotional abuse. They really
mm-hmm.
can. You know, you can talk to some children who have now adults who've gone through horrific childhood, and sometimes they were given the option, you know, do you want to be, you know, beat with this belt, or do you want, you know, something else? And they would take the beating because it was easier. It was more straightforward than,
sure.
than whatever sort of emotional or, you know, societal or mental abuse that might come down the road. And also why we as a culture has decided that something like solitary confinement is one of the worst things that you can do to anybody, you know. And
right.
All of that is mental. All of that is in your head. And it makes a big difference.
I just got a message.
Go ahead.
Oh, no, I was just going to say,
Mary.
I got a message from a friend of mine in Australia who has a question
mm-hmm.
for Miguel.
Mm-hmm.
He says, I have never had a regression of any kind. Were you in any way afraid or concerned about the process of hypnosis before you came to it, and how did you deal with those fears, if any? And he says, listening in Australia.
Hi, Australia. No, I didn't have any fear of the regression process, and I think a lot of that has to do with the initial talk you have with the practitioner. You know, when I spoke to Mary, mm-hmm. I felt very comfortable, and she just has a warm, compassionate voice, and even during the pre-talk, you just feel, I feel... just comfortable.
Good for you,
Miguel. Thank you. I felt comfortable and cared for, and at that point, you know, I was able to relax because I didn't really have any fears at that point, because I knew that she knew what she was doing, and you know, everything would be fine. And I also know that a lot of times in these processes, the biggest fears come from resisting, and when you resist, that's usually when the situation is gets more challenging, instead of just letting it mm-hmm. go where it's supposed to go.
Mm-hmm.
So no fear.
That's, That's a great answer. You know, when people call me or contact me through email and say, you know, I might be interested in a session, you know, maybe, you know, but I'm in Poughkeepsie, New York, or I'm in, you know, wherever, I say, listen, you had the intuition to find Dolores Cannon. You have the intuition to find the right practitioner for yourself. And so some of that fear, of course, is, you know, what is your comfort level? What is, I think Bashar's the one who talks about the permission slip. What is your permission slip for how you're going to heal and who you're going to talk to? And I really think that there are thousands of practitioners all over the world. Find the one that you feel comfortable with and don't settle for anything less. And if you have to drive 500 miles to get to them, you know, go there. I mean, I say to some of my clients, some people will leave Maryland and drive 500 miles to get away from me and go to somebody else, just as somebody else might drive all the way from, you know, 500 miles away to come here. So, you know, find the person you're comfortable with, and then there will be no fear, and there will be no discomfort. Candace, do you think that's true? Do you find the same thing?
Absolutely. Absolutely. You just need to feel as if you trust that person. And sometimes it's a simple personality match. It doesn't necessarily mean somebody is better than another person and that the same person may be right for everybody. It's definitely vibrational match, and you kind of need to, you know, follow your instinct on that for sure. And actually, Michelle, there's a question in the chat room, and Michelle would like to know about how long, if it's all right for you all to share, how long did your session last from the moment, Miguel, you showed up to Mary's office and by the time you left? Because these are kind of long days, you know. Today I got there at 9 a.m. and I didn't leave till almost 5, and that was just one session with one person. How long in total did you spend with Mary for your regression session, Miguel?
I think that time you gave is about right. If I'm correct, I think 10 or 10:30, and I know the time that I was in the car when I left was 4:30.
Yeah.
So it was a couple hours. Well, yeah.
Well, Miguel was actually under for a long time. He was under for close to 3 hours.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, which is long for a session, very, very long. But he was under for about 3 hours, and I think his interview was probably between 2.5 and 3 hours.
Mm-hmm.
And then, of course, there's a little bit of after chat. So, you know, that takes about 20 minutes to 30 minutes. So, yeah, you were probably there for close to 7 hours.
Yeah.
It's a long day.
These are not like your hour or even 2 hour sessions. And really, if any practitioner out there thinks or even tells you that you can come for a QHHT session and be in and out the door in 3 hours, I would really question that. And there's something else that I do want to mention very briefly, and that is, even though both Mary and I are fairly experienced practitioners in the scheme of those out there who are practicing, Dolores' method is very forgiving. And I have said it once, and I've said it 500 times, and that is the most important thing for a practitioner to have, the most important qualification for them to have, is an open heart. It's an amazing method, and sometimes brand new, fresh out of the box, wet behind the ears, just learned the method the day before, practitioners can facilitate amazing sessions of healing and exploration because the intent is correct and matches between both client and practitioner, and amazing things can happen.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more with that, because, you know, over and over again, we see people fresh out of the, you know, level one class having incredible sessions.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I heard from the SC once a couple of months ago. It said, we had asked, you know, what kind of prayer do you want the client to make to make this happen, or what can we do? What words can he use? And the SC said, words never, never matter. It doesn't matter who you pray to or what you say. All that
right.
matters is the intention.
Yes.
And so I think the same is true of practitioners. And, you know, I love it that a couple of years ago when the online classes started, you know, I did a session mm-hmm. with a practitioner who'd been doing Dolores's work for a long time. And she said, I just don't know if these online sessions can, you know, these online classes will be good enough to really train people. And mm-hmm. we asked the SC, and the SC said, the online classes are perfect. You need to train as many people as fast
mm-hmm.
as possible.
Mm-hmm.
And I loved that answer. I just loved
mm-hmm.
it. Just get them out there. Get these practitioners out there.
Yeah. That's really great. You know, I happened to take my class back in 2008. And in my class that year was a truly lovely man who was a long-time hypnotherapist who was opening up his mind to this idea of past life regression. Back when I took the class, it was still called Dolores Cannon's Method of Past Life Regression. And he was a lovely man, and I met him and his wife at the class, and we spent a little time. Actually, we were touring a beautiful cemetery in the area in Arkansas at one point. We spent a lovely afternoon picnicking there, and we stayed in touch, and he practiced the method for about a year. And I remember he sent me an email, and he said, I'm not going to do this anymore. I'm just not going to do it anymore. I haven't seen any results. And I was kind of stunned because he was a really nice man, and he seemed to have an open heart, and he seemed to really care. And I asked myself in a SC session, I asked, you know, what was up with that? Because I'd seen a variation of that play out in other people over the years. And the SC said that his belief system changed the vibration of him and the combination of him and the client together just changed because he had this doubt that it was actually
mm-hmm.
working. And his doubt changed the equation. It changed the mathematical equation, and it kind of kept things from happening. And so, whereas Mary and I were just saying that sometimes we've seen fresh out of the gate practitioners facilitate amazing sessions because their clients or, you know, the people they're practicing on were ready and their intent was to heal or to have discoveries. I've also seen the absolute exact opposite, which is somebody who has done this for maybe even years. And practitioners, and most of them aren't even practicing anymore, but I can think of a couple that I know who gave this method a shot for a couple of years but had such a doubt in their own mind that the results didn't show. And they
mm-hmm.
weren't able to talk about clients that had healings like Miguel's. And the more and more I thought about it, the more I thought and talked about it with these people, their own belief systems, you know, we're stopping both perhaps those that were showing up for healing or those who were able to show up for healing. And the combination just wasn't working out. And I think, go ahead, Mary.
No, I was just going to say it's interesting because I read this wonderful thing on a, I think it was a channel from Marilyn, I think her name is Marilyn Raphael. She channels, I don't know, somebody, the Arcturians maybe, and she
mm-hmm.
said that the way Jesus healed was that he didn't heal, he revealed. And so because
mm-hmm.
he saw people in perfect health and saw people
mm-hmm.
in their complete oneness and their complete healed self, that was how they became healed, which is intention. That's just pure intention. And I believe that. I think that, you know, the relationship between the practitioner and the client is all, you know. The practitioner really needs to
mm-hmm.
see the person as whole and healed right from the start.
Well, okay. Miguel, is there anything else that you'd like to add before we thank you very much for your time and give you back your evening? Thank you so much for showing up. Is there anything else that you'd like to say about your session?
Actually, the biggest thing is I really want to come on to let people know and just understand that this is very real. It may seem far out, but it does work. You know, it does help. And I was never one to put my whole business out there on the internet, but I thought that it was important to let anyone who in the future who's going to doubt that, you know, this may or may not work, or if I could just sort of push them over the edge a little bit to let them know that it's very real. You know,
nice, Miguel.
You're welcome.
That's really nice.
I can't thank you enough too, Miguel. Like I said, it's very rare for people to, you know, to come out publicly and talk like this. And you're a very special man and very wise. And I've enjoyed speaking with you and Mary this evening a lot. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you. Thank you for having me on.
All right, Miguel, take
evening.
Care of yourself.
All right, you too.
Okay, bye-bye.
No. Bye-bye.
All right, well, Mary, Michelle in the chat room is going to be joining us now. And Michelle, you are on. I think you have a question for Mary.
Hi, Mary. How are you?
I'm fine. Thank you, Michelle. How are you?
I'm doing wonderful. And Candace, you can join on this as well. But my question is, I know when I took the online class, and by the way, I haven't finished it out. It's been at least 8 months, maybe. I haven't finished out final, you know, I haven't done any more practice on it. But when I took the class, one of the ideas I had was to hope to have clients that I could ask for permission to go into a little bit of questions with the subconscious on metaphysical details. Like, you know, I noticed, Mary, that you had said that you asked about the shift that was coming up.
Mm-hmm.
And
mm-hmm.
some people who come in, Candace had mentioned to me, that some people who come in, they come in specifically for healing. And perhaps they're not open-minded enough or metaphysical enough to want, you know, to ask that question to their subconscious and it be on their recording or whatever. Later on, mm-hmm. they'll be like, what does that mean?
Mm-hmm.
So do you just have to play it by ear depending on, you know, you hope that somebody walks in that is cool and open to all that stuff and that you actually have time, maybe 20 minutes, 15 minutes, to ask some burning questions that you always wanted to, you know, to know as far
mm-hmm.
as energy or what else is, you know, things on the other side. How do you gauge that when you have a client?
Okay, that's such an interesting question. So first of all, I will just say that when a client comes in, I have absolutely no expectation of needing anything from them. I never want or need or expect anything from a client. And so questions that I have of a metaphysical nature, I expect to have answered through my own knowing and through my own relationship to spirit. So that's number one. But that said, there are some people who come in who have very playful subconsciouses or very, you know, who are really open to having wonderful conversations about all sorts of things. So mm-hmm. I absolutely, as you say, play it by ear. So, you know, I'll give you a funny example. I had a client a couple of months ago who came in, and he had the thickest accent I have ever heard of somebody who lived in New Jersey. He was a really wonderful guy, really nice guy, owned a series of pizza restaurants, but typical New Jersey guy, kind of 60 years old, hadn't been to school past the age of 12. I think he actually had some trouble understanding some of the words that I used and would kind of, you know, what are you talking about there, you know, whatever. And we had a great time talking about the things he needed. He really needed a healing on his back. And so we went into the healing, you know, we went into some past lives, we did a few things. And then when it came to the subconscious came through and no accent, spoke in complete sentences using big words. completely different from the client. And we had an adventure like you wouldn't believe. We talked about all sorts of things and, you know, took all kinds of adventures in terms of what do you think's happening with this and that and blah, blah, blah. And then, you know, I counted him out. He came back to the living room. We sat down to talk, and I looked at him, and I thought, like, I can barely talk to you because your subconscious was so amazing to chat with. And so a lot of questions got answered. So, but both for both of us, you know. And so I guess my answer to your question is you never know what's going to happen with a client. And at the very beginning of a session, I will say if it comes up and if your subconscious is willing, I will probably ask some questions about the state of the world in general. And I may even ask a question where I say, you know, how about some advice for Dolores Cannon practitioners? And if I feel the subconscious is particularly comfortable with talking to me, I might even say, do you have any advice for me specifically? Mm-hmm. So I do play it by ear, but I think the most important thing, Michelle, is that I never expect anything from my client. I don't do this work for myself on some level. I do it because I'm interested in it, but I don't do it out of any need to learn information from clients. Does that make sense, Candace? Do you sort of agree with that?
Absolutely. Dolores, as many of her books that talked about, you know, universal and global and human knowledge, she was adamant. This is about the client. This is about the client's needs, and we may spend all day long with them, and we still may not get to all of the things that are important to them. You know, I would hazard to say that most sessions, it seems like to me, or a majority of sessions anyway, more than half, this universal language and information really doesn't, it's not as much a part of the session as very personal, very pertinent information for the client themselves. And every once in a while, a nugget may come out. Like today, you know, my session today was all about this person, all about her contract and her relationship with people and her own awakening. But within that, I got to hear about, you know, this life extension in her contract, you know, and mm-hmm. I got to ask a few questions about that could possibly, you know, what Dolores Cannon would do at this point is make a note of, wow, you know, a life extension and a contract. Let's see if I hear that again anywhere
exactly.
in the future.
Yeah,
and then
exactly.
she would begin to correlate it. But she wouldn't go into a session and start asking questions about that. And quite frankly, over the years, and it's been very rare, but I've heard of sometimes practitioners, you know, kind of taking that, you know, that in and that and not being very heart-centered about the connection of that information and asking questions that are far too selfish and personal that would make most practitioners of Dolores Cannon's method cringe. I mean, we just don't go there. You know,
no, we don't
we
go
wait
there.
For,
no.
We wait for the wonderful nuggets of information that come our way if we're particularly aligned and particularly open and the client is there for exploration. We may say, yes, I'm really interested in manifestation too. Can we talk about that? But in general, people show up and they travel to get stuff fixed like Miguel did, you know, his ankle, his relationship,
right.
his, you know, his heart. And if the other stuff comes out, if the other information comes out that we get excited about, that's gravy.
Yeah, you know, it's so funny because I think the two most exciting things that have ever happened of that nature to me was at one point I was talking to an SC that was very powerful and very and empowered by the client, and they sort of laughed and said I said, we like you. And I remember sort of turning into mush and saying, well, I love you. Thank you so much for coming to see me and talking to me. I felt so humbled. It was this sort of like begrudging, like, yeah, we like you. Like, well, you know, we like you. And the other time that was actually really felt totally holy to me, I think, was I had a client who was a hairdresser from upstate New York. She came all the way down here to see me, and she didn't have much education, and in the middle of the session, she broke off and started speaking in ancient Sanskrit and turned to me and said, "Mary, Mary, you need this," and you need, started saying all kinds of personal stuff to me out of nowhere. And I still sometimes go back and listen to it because the Sanskrit words were beautiful. The advice was wonderful. And she broke off, said this, and then she went right back mid-sentence to what she was saying before. So, you know, in all the years I've done this, I'd say those are the two times when the SC really turned to me and personally spoke to me. And it just doesn't happen that often. So, you know, if I want to know the answers to any metaphysical questions, I just open a Dolores Cannon book. I don't really, I'm not looking for the clients to do that for me. Does that answer your question, Michelle, sort of?
It does. As Candace knows, when I decided to take the class, my number one priority was helping Greg to heal his back, and I'm a hands-on healer, and he's been to hands-on healers, and we worked on his back several times, and we realized that he was going to need to probably face the past life that was causing the pain where he was holding on to the energy, and so we thought it would be a really good way to get him healed, and then we began discussing several things, like what if we could get an agreement from his SC to ask questions while I practice on him and do things and ask questions that we could share with other people. It was all about sharing information about what was coming up because, you know, we reach quite a lot of people and we thought it would be fascinating to write articles around. You know, so we were trying to use it in a way, in two ways. One was all about healing Greg. And the other was about, well, if while we're there, why don't we ask some questions? And I'm thinking that might have been the block that might have kept us from getting further than we were because of the expectations or the excitement and use that we thought that we could use it for while we were there. It was like, you know, two birds with one stone type thing. So, yeah.
You know, you really have a point there because Dolores would say in classes, you know, she would say the SC is only going to work with you if you're, you know, if you're aligned correctly. And if people... And I'm not saying you had an idea of misusing or whatever, but she would talk about the idea of the SC coming through, and you know, it's kind of like a combination lock. All these things have to be aligned and ready, and you, we can guess, but we can't always really know. Well, what is it that's off a little bit that is keeping from, you know, keeping anything from happening. And I think that you're actually spot on. That may have been one of the things that kind of, you know, let's just say threw a wrench in what was going on, because intent is absolutely everything.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, the intent was from our hearts, and we both were on the same page, but it really isn't used to be a psychic forecaster or to we probably would have asked questions about ascension and the shift if we would have gotten that far. We would have really gone there. So that's why I wanted to bring this up in case.
There are times, Michelle, when an SC is very, very powerful and very authoritative and very, you can just tell that they're at a very high level. And there are times when I have said, tell me about what's coming, tell me about what's happening. But it has a feeling less of curiosity than of just a profound kind of, you actually have a message and this is the vehicle through which you need to give it to humanity. And at that point, I the only way that I usually communicate it to anybody is through the forum, because I do believe that the QHHD forum is the place on the planet right now where this kind of information is proliferated at the highest level. And so I don't feel the need to put it on Facebook or on, you know, Twitter or on whatever. It's within a group of people who are seriously dedicated to thinking and learning about what's happening on the planet and working with the subconscious level and the highest levels, really, in a profound way. So, yes, this information does come through, and, you know, it's on the forum. You know, I don't know, is that okay to say, Candace?
It's absolutely okay to say, because, you know, I know I talked to Michelle about that before the creation of this show, you know, even happened, was that everything that Dolores talked about and we all get so excited about in her books happens in sessions all around the world to practitioners just like you, just like me, and just like people who just finished the class last week. I swear to God it happens. And it's amazing, and it's just expanding and it's expanding and it's expanding. And actually, Michelle earlier had asked in the chat room how people can find a practitioner, and there's a couple different ways. You can go to DoloresCannon.com, and there's a find a practitioner list there. And then there's also a special kind of premium listing of people who are actually on the forum that I actually created many years ago with Dolores' blessing, that's been going on now for 7.5 years, and it's the forum that Mary and I talk about in all the time and how we know each other, and we talk to colleagues and other practitioners, and we share information like that. And those people are at a special listing place that has photographs, and they're kind of business card listings. And that website is DoloresCannonQHHT.com. And that's a site that's kept very current daily on listings. People come and go. We have new practitioners all the time. And that's a great place to start. And it's by country and state and all of that, and you can see if somebody is near you. But really, the most important thing, like Mary and I talked about before, both of us, which is make a connection, look at the picture, absolutely make a call and see how you feel about the person on the other line. And if you feel comfortable, then maybe that's the right practitioner for you. But if you have any reservations, anything happening in your gut, Keep looking.
Yeah. Michelle, I want to ask you, is Greg's back better?
Yes, it is. There were several things that we did with healing his back. One was I did get him to the cloud, which we realized, and we talked about this on one of the other shows with Candace, we realized that I actually had him in this almost a subconscious level right then, when I was actually trying to force bringing him down from the cloud into a past life. And every time he would come off the cloud, there would be black. He just couldn't see anything, and his mind was just basically still there. His consciousness was still there, getting in the way, saying, you know, he'd open up one eye and look at me and say, I'm still here, you know, basically. But I knew he was there. I knew he was already in the light state, because he was, and it was basically with Source at the time that he was on the cloud. And if I would have been more knowledgeable, I think I would have begun asking him questions then, and not about past lives, but talk to his subconscious right there and maybe gotten to the issue. But just by, Candace and I have talked about this, just by the fact that we made the intention to heal him through that could have been the beginning of his healing. But he also had a session in upstate New York on the John of God bed. And it was that session that finally sealed the deal, got off the table, and his pain was gone.
Well, you know, we always say that QHHT sometimes just opens the door for the next whatever, or helps. You know, it's just another piece of the puzzle that will get you there. And, you know, one of the things that I loved about Dolores was Dolores would say this all the time. You know, there isn't anything completely magical and amazing and unique about QHHT. It's a tool like there are very many other tools. Now, I'm sort of biased, and I would almost not want to agree because it's just such an encompassing, amazing technique that's forever fascinating and so valuable and helpful for so many. But Dolores would say there's a lot of ways to get to this place. And, you know, different kinds of modalities. And it's not the only place that'll get you there. And sometimes it is the thing that will help just take you to the next place where, you know, then something will shift. So mm-hmm. so that we always say that, you know, it's worth an afternoon or a day, depending on exploration, you know. And I've not yet in all of these years that I've been practicing, ever really had a bad experience, really not ever at all. And I could say the same thing for clients. I've had a couple of them, you know, sort of shrug maybe and say, well, that wasn't exactly what I wanted. But it's never been detrimental. There's never been a bad experience. And I just can't say enough about it. And I'm as excited about this method now as I was when I first took my first class back in 2008. And being a part of the QHHT support forum where we can trade and these stories and share, you know, things that happened and offer each other advice just makes us all better practitioners. And it's a great continuing education program for those who go through both the live and online classes. And we just keep getting bigger, and the community is fabulous, and it's just amazing. And I'm happy to click over there every day and see what's going on and meet people like my good friend Mary.
How do people find the forum? Do you have to sign up and create an account?
Anyone who's ever taken a class from Dolores is welcome to join our forum, and it's pretty much as simple as that. Yeah, you can send an email to me. You can find me at newearthjourney.com or qhhtforum@gmail.com, or there's a variety of ways. You know, DoloresCannon.com. Any practitioner can also give you.
Just call the office, right?
Yeah, and they'll give you information on how to find us. And, you know, we're coming up on beginning our eighth year, and we're just getting bigger all the time and all across the entire planet.
Well, that's exciting. Thank you for taking my question.
Of course.
I love the show.
Oh,
thank
your
you.
Heart. Well, thank you for coming on and helping, especially at the beginning a little bit with the tech stuff. But like I said, you know, if Art Bell was having tech problems with Mercury in retrograde, he had to cancel his show last night. So I thought, well, we've done better than that. We've had a few
yes,
hiccups on the show today.
Yeah,
but
we had a little,
but we
little
didn't.
Bit of a glitch.
Oh, I had a glitch last night. Brought my first guest on a few minutes prior to the show and dropped completely off. After, you know, getting all ready, we're ready to go, drop completely off. So, and then I have had to cancel one whole show as well with glitches. And people are wondering when I can reschedule that one. So we'll work through these. And, gosh, I'm just glad we have Internet, you know.
Yeah, it's wonderful.
Candace,
thank you so much. Candace, thank you so much. And Michelle also for hosting. And just thank you for having me on the show. It's been really fun. And I'm so glad we had a chance to get Miguel on the show.
Oh, me too, Mary. You were fabulous. So, Mary, why don't you tell our listeners how they may find you and where exactly you're located in case they might want to contact you for a session?
Sure. I live in Annapolis, Maryland, which is a beautiful the sailing capital of the East Coast. Lovely town to come to. A lot of people travel from some pretty big distances to come here because it's a great place to visit anyway. My website is healingacrosstime.com, and I'm on Facebook as also a page called Healing Across Time, and I'd love to hear from anybody who'd love a session.
Super. Okay. And Michelle, how can everyone find you for coaching and other things? How can we find you, Michelle Walling?
Oh, well, thanks for asking that, Candace. I mean, it's not my show, but michellewalling.com is my website. And if somebody needed to contact you, Candace, to come on your show, how could they do that?
The best place to find me is through my own website, which is newearthjourney.com.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much, ladies.
It really has been a great time. Good night, everyone, and join us next week. I hope to tackle the often asked questions of a QHHT practitioner next time. So join us then next Friday at 7 p.m. Central and 8 p.m. Eastern. And thank you so much, listeners. And good night, everyone.
Good night, Candace. Good night, Michelle.
Be well.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.